Expand your vocabulary with our Core 2000 Words ebook. It's free and packed with essential expressions that you'll use on a daily basis. Start building your vocabulary today. Click the link in the description below to download your free Chinese ebook before it's gone. When learning a new language, everyone should have an ultimate goal to work towards. Whether you want to be able to connect with a relative, easily order food while traveling, or go somewhere new, having an end goal for your learning can be very motivating. A popular but challenging goal is being able to speak like a native speaker. It's difficult to measure exactly when you reach this goal, and it's not something you can pick up using textbooks alone. So how do you work on making your speech more natural? That's what we're going to look at today. Here are three tips to help you practice talking like a native speaker. Number one, focus on vocabulary. If your goal is to speak like a native, you might be really focused on speaking quickly or using as many complex grammar patterns as possible. But in our native languages, we're not always trying to speak as fast as possible. And we use complex grammar patterns when necessary, not to show off. Vocabulary, however, is extremely important to expressing ourselves naturally. Your choice of words can reveal a lot about you and your understanding of the language. Most learners have had the experience of using a phrasebook or a dictionary to find a word they want to use, trying the word in conversation, and getting a look of confusion from the native speaker. In some cases, although your word choice may be grammatically correct, the word may be inappropriate for the situation or totally unnatural. This is especially important in business and other formal situations, where the right level of formality and professionalism is key. Being able to understand nuances in vocabulary words can also help you understand relationships between people just by listening to the conversation. Try to listen to many different types of conversations. Listen to how people talk to their friends, their superiors, and in customer service situations. This will give you a better idea of how to talk to others naturally. In some languages, you can omit words from sentences or use more direct communication styles. It's important to be aware of these things so you can apply them yourself. Colloquialisms and slang are also commonly used in most languages. As this sort of vocabulary is always evolving, it can be difficult to keep up with the latest words. Talk with native speakers and consume media in your target language to make sure you pick up these kinds of expressions. Media is a great resource for your learning. Ultimately, knowing the appropriate vocabulary to use for each situation will really help you sound more knowledgeable. Number two, perfect your accent. With every language, there are unique pronunciation and intonation challenges. Some languages are tonal languages, and a change in pitch can completely change the meaning of a word. Then there's the fact that most countries have multiple dialects, and so people from one area of the country may sound different from those in another. So, what is the best way to listen to a wide range of accents and different pronunciations? Video and audio resources are a great way to do this. YouTube is a perfect place to start because people from all kinds of different backgrounds upload videos to the platform. You can watch educational videos, daily life vlogs, cooking shows, a travel series, whatever interests you. Pay attention to the different ways people speak. Everyone is unique. And then practice speaking like them. This kind of practice can help you sound more natural. One note, please be aware of the type of resources you're using. For example, if you find a video where a speaker uses a rare dialect, it might not be a good idea to use that for your pronunciation practice, unless you have a special reason for studying a specific accent. As a general rule, it's best to try to search for practice resources that use a standard form of the language you're studying. Number three, copy what you hear. Do you remember how you learned to speak as a child? We rarely learned new words just listening to them, or reading after we learned how. When we were little kids, we imitated the sounds we heard by repeating the sounds out loud. While you're talking to a friend, watching videos, or listening to audio in your target language, you can do this to try and replicate the way they speak. Doing this will help you work on mastering the flow of the language, your accent, intonation, and pronunciation. Of course, you might also pick up some new vocabulary this way. Make sure to repeat new words often. It's a great way to make sure you remember them. Try doing this using a number of different mediums and sources. That way, you'll be exposed to the diversity that the language offers and master the fundamentals of pronunciation. For example, You can watch and imitate several different YouTube videos and audio CDs, but try a few different sources, like different creators or different audio types, to make sure you experience a wide range of communication in your target language. If you're using our language learning program, you can even get your own teacher with Premium Plus. Your teacher can answer questions, give assignments, and even listen to your recordings and give you advice on pronunciation. Completing these kinds of lessons with a native teacher can really boost your confidence in your speaking skills. Becoming able to speak like a native is a popular goal for many people learning a new language. It feels great to be able to communicate smoothly, especially when the people you're talking to expect basic level sentences or broken communication. Try using the tips we've shared in this video to work on improving your speaking skills. Of course, it'll take time and persistence, but the reward will be more natural communication. And for even more tips on speaking, check out our complete language learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Get tons of resources to have you speaking in your target language. And if you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye.
Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Kate. What we will do today? We're going to eat hot pot. 今天我们要去吃火锅。So what is hot pot? 什么是火锅呢？火锅是以水或汤导热锅来涮煮食物的烹调方式。火锅要边煮边吃，由于锅本身是具有保温效果的，所以吃的时候食物始终是热的。中国的火锅有很多不同的口味，今天我们要吃的是重庆火锅。重庆火锅最大的特点就是麻辣，一起走吧。店之后，我们会拿到这样一份菜单，我们可以选择自己喜欢的蔬菜和肉类。这就是重庆火锅。是我点的甜品冰汤圆。在吃火锅之前，我们需要制作一份蘸料。一般来说，我会用香油、盐和蒜来制作蘸料。为了更方便地煮食物，我们加了一个这样的格子。这个是牛肉，我们只需要把它煮大约一分钟就可以吃了。一定不要忘记使用你的蘸料哦。这个是毛肚，用筷子夹住，煮10秒就可以了。
这是藕，大约要煮三分钟。这是土豆，煮两分钟即可。这是耗儿鱼，最少要煮十分钟。这个是鸭肠，用筷子夹住，煮十秒。下雨天吃火锅实在是太棒了。好了，现在我要回家了。
有很多外国人第一次吃火锅都不敢尝试像毛肚和鸭肠这样的食材，但是我强烈建议大家都试一试，因为真的是太美味了。After hot pot, let's learn some important phrases. 吃完火锅之后，让我们一起来学习几个非常重要的表达吧。Alright, follow me. 火锅，火锅 ，hot pot. 菜单，菜单 ，menu. 蘸料。蘸料 dipping sauce 麻辣麻辣 spicy and hot 如果让我用一个词形容重庆火锅我会说完美如果让我用一个词形容重庆火锅我会说完美 If I have to use one word to describe Chongqing's hot pot it will be perfect Alright, it is today's Chinese class. If you want to know more about Chinese food, please leave a comment, let me know. And if you like my videos, please don't forget to give me a thumbs up and subscribe. See you next time. Bye bye.
Hello, I'm Cui Chen. 2月14日是西方的情人节。近年来，情人节已在年轻人中间十分流行。成为中国人最喜爱的西方节日之一。中国的情人节是什么样子的呢？下面一起来学习一下吧。你知道中国传统的情人节叫做什么吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。在这一天，人们会赠送礼物给情人或心仪的人，例如送巧克力、贺卡和鲜花等，用于表达爱意或友好。最典型的庆祝方式就是男生送女生玫瑰，女生送男生巧克力。这一天你会看到到处都是约会的甜蜜的情侣们，羡煞旁人。不但情人们在这一天别具匠心地对爱人表达爱意，许多商家也如法炮制，将这一天烘衬得充满爱意。比如举办各种各样由情侣一起参加的比赛，来考验爱情的契合程度。比如有的购物中心会在商场门口搭建舞台，邀请路过的消费者参加接吻大赛，坚持亲吻最长的一对情侣可以拿到奖品。与情人节相对比，近年在中国的流行文化中产生了一个有趣的节日，叫做光棍节，是每年的11月11日。在这一天，还单身的人会一起庆祝这个节日。另外，如今的流行用语中， 人们管适龄结婚却依然单身的女孩叫做剩女，单身的男孩叫做光棍。所以这一天，几个单身汉相约吃饭、喝酒、看电影的话，也叫做光棍的聚会。在汉语中，情人有时包含情妇、情夫，即合法婚姻以外的男女关系的意味。所以当你向别人介绍自己的男朋友、女朋友时，千万不要说他是你的情人，也许会被别人误会的。现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。你知道中国传统的情人节叫做什么吗？中国传统的情人节是七夕节，每年农历的七月初七。在这个系列的第九课中，已经详细介绍了七夕的起源和习俗，想必大家早已熟识。怎么样，还记得吗？这节课你觉得怎么样？你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，情人节是如何度过的呢？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课再见。大家好，我是崔晨。每年12月25日是西方传统的圣诞节。近年来，圣诞节在中国已成为一个非常受欢迎的节日，越来越多的人参与庆祝这一节日。那么在中国，人们过圣诞节又有什么不同呢？下面一起来了解一下吧。圣诞节在中国有了许多本土化的改造，也创造了许多只有中国才有的圣诞产物，比如近年来颇为流行的圣诞果。你知道它是什么吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。在中国大陆，圣诞节不是假日，但在改革开放后，随着民众逐渐认识和接受圣诞节，近年来庆祝圣诞节的活动逐渐增加，参与者主要是追求新奇的年轻人。此外，澳门受前宗主国葡萄牙影响，圣诞节是官方假日。香港也是24日到26日，放假3天。中国式圣诞节指的是圣诞节在中国越来越具有中国特色。这些中国特色有时令人着迷，有时令人困惑。因为商业的炒作以及年轻人的追捧正在变味儿。圣诞节在西方是和家人在一起团聚，而中国人过圣诞节的典型活动则意味着外出娱乐，包括看电影、去卡拉 OK 或者购物等等。圣诞节通常对于庆祝圣诞节的国家来说是最大的一年一度的经济刺激，在中国也同样是充满商机的节日。圣诞前夜是一年中最重要的购物时段，商业中心的商场、餐厅都会以圣诞装饰点缀装潢，各处充满了浓浓的节日气氛。而年轻的情侣或夫妻一直把它视为一个浪漫的日子，所以很多电影大片选择在这个档期上映。作为圣诞节的吉祥物，圣诞老人为人熟知。但令人困惑的是，在中国，圣诞老人越来越多作为萨克斯的演奏者出现，有时候则演奏圆号、小提琴，甚至是喇叭。也许这份创意最初来自于推广圣诞概念的商家的无力之举，却慢慢变成了具有中国特色的意境。现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。圣诞节在中国有了许多本土化改造，也创造了许多只有中国才有的圣诞产物，比如近年来颇为流行的圣诞果。你知道它是什么吗？圣诞果是中国圣诞节最常见的礼物。圣诞节的前一天晚上是平安夜，苹果则因为谐音身价倍增，成为平安果。这些普通的苹果经过一番包装，价格不菲。这节课你觉得怎么样？ 你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，圣诞节是怎么庆祝的呢？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课再见。大家好，我是崔晨。四月一日的愚人节是从西方传来的节日，年轻人会以各种各样新奇的方式向周围的人来开玩笑庆祝这一天。不过中国的老年人对这个节日可不感冒。愚人节在中国是什么样的呢？下面我们来了解一下吧。愚人是愚蠢的人的意思，但是它也不全是贬义。中国历来有许多闻名历史的愚人，有一个人叫做愚公，你听说过他的故事吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。愚人节最典型的活动还是大家互相开玩笑，用假话捉弄对方。比如告诉一个人，有人在某某处等他，让他白跑一趟之类的。很显然，在学校里这是一个极其受欢迎的节日，大家都憋足了坏主意在这一天捉弄同学玩。这一天最经典的屡试不爽的玩笑，大概就是对你的朋友说你的鞋带开了，毫无防备的对方一定会低头看一下，甚至是蹲下去系鞋带，即使他今天根本没有穿带鞋带的鞋。类似的还有你的钱包不见了，你桌子上的水洒了，你的老师叫你去办公室，或者你的领导叫你去谈话，等等等等。这些愚人节整人的把戏和在你的国家里流行的是不是很相似呢？随着网络的普及，愚人节也不仅只是单一的现实中的玩笑整蛊，近年来早已延伸到网络上。每年愚人节都会有林林总总整人页面在网络上广泛传播。如果你不小心点了朋友发来的整人链接，那你可就惨了。有可能几分钟之内要一直点鼠标，企图关掉那个页面。或者你的电脑会中个善意的自动重启的小病毒。由于是愚人节，一切东西都有带玩笑的性质。有些人会选择在这一天向心爱的人表白，他们心想，如果遭到拒绝就说，愚人节，骗你的。这种行为是不是有点胆小鬼呢？现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。愚人是愚蠢的人的意思，但是它也不全是贬义。中国历来有许多闻名历史的愚人，有一个人叫做愚公，你听说过他的故事吗？愚公移山是一个著名的传说，有一个古人不畏惧艰难，坚持不懈，挖山不止，最终感动天地而将山挪走的故事。人们用愚公移山来比喻和歌颂做事有毅力、有恒心、不怕困难的品格。这节课你觉得怎么样？你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，愚人节都有哪些捉弄人的把戏呢？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课再见。大家好，我是崔晨。除夕也叫做大年夜，是农历一年中的最后一天，是中国传统节日中最重大的节日之一。除夕过后就是正月初一，新一年的开始，过春节也就是过除夕之夜。下面让我们来一起了解一下吧。除夕当晚的团圆饭中必须有一道鱼做的菜肴，你知道是为什么吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。除夕因常在腊月三十，故又称该日为年三十。 除夕的字面意思还有旧岁除去，明日即换新岁的意思。这一夜人们往往通宵不眠，叫做守岁。除夕这一天，家里家外不但要打扫得干干净净，还要贴门神、贴春联、贴年画。人们则换上带喜庆色彩和带图案的新衣，来庆祝春节的到来。关于除夕起源的传说有很多，最为著名的说法是讲夕是一个妖怪，它专门害人，所以每年的腊月三十，人们都等待着，希望早日除掉夕，于是就有了除夕的说法。可是一年年过去了，谁也没有再见过夕，有的只是大家防止夕的到来燃放的爆竹与门前挂的红布条。夕不再来，然而却给我们留下了这个有趣的传说与过年的习俗。在除夕这一天的饮食习俗上，北方人风俗一致，即过年包饺子，而南方则因不同的地域有着诸多不同的过年习俗，或做年糕，或包粽子，或煮汤圆，或吃米饭等等。水饺形似元宝，年糕因似年糕，都是吉祥如意的好兆头。除夕当晚，人们要遵守一些守岁的禁忌，禁忌大声喧哗，以免惊醒恶魔，禁忌照镜子，以免看见恶魔，禁忌打碎器物，意味着这些年会有破运。补救方式是用红纸包起，口中念岁岁平安等吉祥话，并放在神案上数天，即可化解灾难。现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。除夕当晚的团圆饭中必须有一道鱼做的菜肴，你知道是为什么吗？除夕之夜，全家人在一起吃团圆饭，有一家人团聚过年的味道。吃团圆饭时一定会上一道鱼做的佳肴，因为这鱼代表着富裕和年年有余，象征来年的财富与幸运。这节课你觉得怎么样？你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，哪些食物也具有象征意义呢？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课，再见。大家好，我是崔晨。每年农历的12月8日是中国传统的腊八节，人们在这一天喝腊八粥、做腊八蒜，是中国各地老百姓最传统也最讲究的习俗。这节课我们就一起来学习有关腊八节的知识吧。腊八节这一天还是算账还钱、催债的日子，你知道是为什么吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。古时一年中的最后一月被称作腊月，腊在古文中有新旧交替的意思，而腊字偏旁是月，这又有肉的意思。古时年末会用牛羊来祭奠神明，因为这些原因，十二月就被叫做腊月了。腊八节这一天最重要的习俗就是喝腊八粥了。腊八粥是用八种本年收获的新鲜粮食和瓜果煮成，味道有甜的，也有咸的。其中北京的腊八粥可以说是最为讲究，材料也是最精挑细选的。除了白米，还要添加红枣、莲子、核桃、栗子、杏仁等等，不下20种，营养十分丰富。此外，腊八粥的制作时间也有其特殊的讲究。腊月初七晚上就要开始洗净食材备用，半月时分开始用微火炖，直到第二天清晨腊八粥才算熬好了。泡腊八蒜则是北方的习俗，把蒜瓣放到一个可以密封容器里面，然后倒入醋，封上口，放到一个冷的地方，慢慢的泡在醋中的蒜就变得通体碧绿，如同翡翠一般，这时就可以拿出来吃了。 在一些地区，腊八节还流传着吃冰的习俗。前一天，人们要用钢盆舀水结冰，等到腊八节，就把冰敲成碎块吃掉。据说这天的冰很神奇，吃了它以后，一年里都不会肚子疼。现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。腊八节这一天还是算账还钱催债的日子，你知道是为什么吗？腊八蒜的蒜字和算字同音，这是各家商号要在这天把一年的收支算出来，可以看出盈亏，其中包括外欠和外债，都要在这天算清楚。腊八蒜就是这么回事儿。腊八这天，要债的债主子要到欠他钱的人家送信儿，叫其准备还钱。这节课你觉得怎么样？你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，人们有喝粥的习惯吗？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课再见。大家好，我是崔晨。五四青年节是为纪念1919年5月4日在中国爆发的五四运动而设立的，它来源于中国1919年反帝爱国的五四运动。在今天，每年的5月4日，法定全国的青年都放假半天来庆祝这个节日。你知道中国法律上对青年人的定义是几岁到几岁吗？我会在这个视频的结尾告诉大家答案哦。五四运动在中国近现代历史上具有重大的意义，因此五四青年节有着浓重的历史烙印。1919年5月4日这一天，北京高校的学生们为了抗议政府在巴黎和会上签订的不平等合约，举行了声势浩大的示威游行活动。这次运动引发了历史上中国新民主主义革命的开始。如今在五四青年节期间，中国各地都会举行丰富多彩的纪念活动，学校和单位里的共青团会组织青年们集中进行社会志愿和社会实践活动，比如去敬老院服务一天，在十字路口帮助交通协管员维护交通秩序之类的。还有许多高中在青年节期间为即将毕业的高三生举行成人仪式，也叫做成人冠礼。虽然五四运动已经过去将近百年，五四运动所倡导的爱国、进步、民主、科学精神仍然被当代所推崇。如今五四已经固定成一种文化符号，具有象征意义。五四青年也有着爱国青年的意思。近年，各大高校校园内刮起一股民国风，许多大学生在五四这一天身穿当年流行的民国学生制服，作为一种传承历史、庆祝节日的方式。现在我来告诉你们前面问题的答案。你知道中国法律上对青年人的定义是几岁到几岁吗？青年人放假适用人群为14至28周岁的青年，三亿多青年将于每年五月四日放假半天。这节课你觉得怎么样？你有学到很多有趣的东西吗？在你的国家，青年们有哪些专属的节日呢？请在 ChineseClass101.com 给我们留言吧。我们下一节课再见。
Want to transform your driving time into language learning time? How much time do you spend in your car every day? 30 minutes? More than an hour? Why not put this huge amount of time to good use? Instead of just listening to the radio during your daily commute, you could be learning a new language instead. Here are three easy methods for learning a language in your car. You can put them to use right away with the help of our language learning program. First, you can listen to fun audio lessons by real teachers. Listening to lessons while in the car allows you to focus on the road as you listen and learn. In every one of our 3 to 15 minute lessons, our teachers teach you conversations, new phrases, and cultural points. Audio is the only learning medium that lets you learn and drive safely at the same time, so take advantage of all our audio lessons available. Second, you can set your lessons on autoplay and go hands-free. Our autoplay feature lets you keep your hands on the wheel without even reaching for your device. Just set your lessons to autoplay one by one with our innovative Language 101 app, and never have to interrupt your focus on driving to switch to a new lesson. Third, you can repeat out loud and speak from your very first lesson. You want to speak a new language too, right? Well, you'll start learning conversations minutes into your lessons. All you have to do is listen and repeat out loud. Our teachers take you step by step through all of the words, phrases, translations, and grammar points. You're even prompted to speak out loud and repeat. The result? You understand it all and can speak your new language. Turn your commute into language learning time and have fun at the same time. Learning doesn't have to be a big commitment, like signing up for a college class. It can be fun and easy. In fact, it's as easy as pressing play. Our language learning programs will do the work for you. And with the exposure you get while driving on your daily commute, you'll be speaking and understanding real-life language quickly. The best part? You can finally learn without even changing your schedule. So if you're ready to finally learn a new language the fast, fun, and easy way, sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Signing up takes less than 30 seconds, and you'll start speaking from your very first lesson. If you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye! Wait! Before we start, do you want a bundle of 30 printable Chinese PDF cheat sheets teaching you words and phrases for conversations for free? Then click the link in the description and sign up for a free lifetime account to get access.
Hello, 大家好，欢迎回到 ChineseClass101.com， 我是云。今天我们将一起学习如何在中国搭乘火车。你会学到如何用中文描述日常生活，并加深对中国文化的了解。这是一个很好的机会来丰富你的词汇，提高你的听力。准备好了吗？那我们开始吧。第一遍听力练习，我会用正常语速，并且没有字幕。听完之后，会有一个简单的小测试，看看你听懂了多少。李佳是上海大学的一名学生，他的家在南京，每年春节他都会坐火车回家。春节前火车票通常很难买到，所以李佳总是提前在网上预订。在手机应用上，他只需要输入姓名和身份证号码，选择时间和座位，支付后就可以拿到车票，非常方便。李佳没有信用卡，所以他选择使用微信支付。乘车当天，李佳提前来到火车站，经过安检后，他排队等待检票。有的人扫描手机上的二维码进站，有的人刷身份证，还有一些老人仍然使用纸质车票。李佳打开手机，扫二维码进站。上车后，李佳迅速找到了自己的座位，把行李放在行李架上，然后拿出一本书，坐下来看。火车开了，这趟车是高铁，速度很快，不到2个小时，李佳就能回到家了。他望着窗外，期待着和父母团聚的时刻。怎么样，不难吧？先出几个简单的问题考考大家。
李佳是哪所大学的学生？ A. 北京大学， B. 上海大学， C. 南京大学。李佳为什么提前在网上订购火车票？ A. 火车票便宜， B. 火车票不好买， C. 火车站太远。在火车站，李佳用什么方式检票进站？ A. 扫手机二维码，B. 使用微信， C. 使用身份证。 李家乘坐的是哪种类型的列车？ A. 普通列车， B. 特快列车， C. 高铁列车。
你都答对了吗？如果没有完全听懂也不要紧，接下来我会用慢速复述一遍刚才的故事。李佳是上海大学的一名学生，他的家在南京，每年春节他都会坐火车回家。春节前火车票通常很难买到，所以李佳总是提前在网上预订。在手机应用上，他只需要输入姓名和身份证号码，选择时间和座位，支付后就可以拿到车票，非常方便。李佳没有信用卡，所以他选择使用微信支付。乘车当天，李佳提前来到火车站，经过安检后，他排队等待检票。有的人扫描手机上的二维码进站，有的人刷身份证，还有一些老人仍然使用纸质车票。李佳打开手机，扫二维码进站。上车后，李佳迅速找到了自己的座位，把行李放在行李架上，然后拿出一本书坐下来看。火车开了，这趟车是高铁，速度很快，不到两个小时李佳就能回到家了。他望着窗外，期待着和父母团聚的时刻。现在咱们一起学习一下重点词汇和短语。春节，学生，网上，预定，提前，手机应用，身份证，座位，支付，安检，检票，纸质，行李，行李架，高铁，团聚。今天我们学习了一些与乘坐火车有关的词汇短语，现在你知道了在中国如何买火车票，如何检票进站。希望这个故事能够让你更了解中国的城市生活，同时提升你的中文听力水平。今天的听力练习就到这里了。在你居住的地方，大家是怎样乘坐火车的呢？在下面留言告诉我吧。还有，不要忘了点赞、分享以及订阅我们的频道，有更多精彩内容等着大家。谢谢大家，下期节目见。
Now that you're finished with this lesson, don't forget, as a free bonus, you get over 30 conversation cheat sheets, but only if you sign up via the link in the description. You'll learn how to have flowing conversations and how to answer the most common questions. You can also print out these colorful cheat sheets to keep as physical study material. So don't miss out on this free gift. Click the link in the description and sign up for a free lifetime account to get your PDF cheat sheets.
Welcome to ChineseClass101.com's 三分钟汉语, the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. Hey, 大家好,我叫马燕如,很高兴与大家见面。Hi, everybody, I'm 燕如马, nice to meet you. In this series, we're going to learn basic Chinese expressions. It's super easy and only takes 3 minutes. In this lesson, you're going to learn how to introduce yourself in Chinese. Ready? Let's get started.
你好，我叫马燕如。
Hi, I'm 燕如马。
你好，我叫马燕如。
Start by saying 你好, which means hello.
你好。
Then say 我叫, which means I'm called.
我叫。
After this, say your name.
你好,我叫马燕如。
Yes, it's just that easy. When you introduce yourself, you might want to tell people a little more their name. Again, it's easy. You're learning Chinese, so let's say you want to tell people you're a Chinese student. In Chinese, this is 中文学生。The first word, 中文。It's the word for the Chinese language.
中文
Next, we have 学生 This means student.
学生
Altogether, it's 中文学生
中文学生
Now, if you want to say, I'm a student, just start with the word for I we learned before.
我
Then add 是, this means is,
是.
After this, add the word for student. Do you remember it?
中文学生,
中文学生. Put them together and you have
我是中文学生, 我是中文学生.
Remember, start by saying hello, then say your name.
你好，我叫马燕如。
Follow with a little bit about you.
我是中文学生。
And now you have a nice self-introduction.
你好，我叫马燕如。我是中文学生。
Now it's time for Yanru's tips. When men introduce themselves, it's very common for them to shake hands. In business situations, women will do this too.In social or casual situations, however, it is common for women to simply nod or smile in order to show friendliness. Do you know how we say thank you in Chinese? Come to our next lesson and you'll see how easy it is.
再见!
See you then!
Hey, 大家好，我是马燕如。
Hi, everybody. I'm 燕如马。
Welcome to ChineseClass101.com's 三分钟汉语 The fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. In the last lesson, we learned how to introduce ourselves in Chinese. In this lesson, we are going to learn how to use good manners as we thank people.
准备好了吗?
Are you ready?
我们开始吧。
So let's start.There are several ways to thank someone. Let's start with the easiest. It is just one word.
谢谢谢谢谢谢 means thanks.
Another slightly more emphatic way of saying thank you is 谢谢你 Do you see what we changed? We just added 你 to the end.
你
As you may recall, this is a word for you.It's like saying, thank you.
谢谢你。谢谢你。
When you really, really want to express thanks to someone, there is a different way to do it.
太谢谢了。太谢谢了。
As we've seen before, 谢谢 means thanks. Here, we've got new word 太, which means to.As in too much of something.
太
And another, 了 Together, this sentence is like, thanks too much.
太谢谢了
How about the response? It's easy,
Let me show you the most basic way to do it.
不用谢，不用谢。用 here means need. 用
Put in the 不 before it makes it negative.
不
Altogether, it's 不用 No need.
不用
Finally, we add 谢 which means thanks. So it means something like no need to thank. We use it just like the English, you're welcome. So when someone says 谢谢 to you, you can simply reply with 不用谢. Now it's time for English tips. Although 谢谢 is simple, it can be used in both formal and informal situations with just about anyone, anywhere, and at any time. But actually in China, we don't usually say 谢谢 to our families and our close friends. The expression, while polite, creates a feeling of distance. But it doesn't mean that we take thankfulness for granted. Instead, we will do something else in the future to show our gratitude. Do you know how to say see you later in Chinese? Here is a hint. I've been saying it at the end of every episode. In our next lesson, we'll go over this in detail and talk about other ways to say goodbye and hello in Chinese. Until then, 再见!
大家好，我叫马燕如。Hey everybody, I'm 燕如 Ma. Welcome to Chinese Class 101.com's 三分钟汉语 the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. In the last lesson, we learned how to show gratitude by saying 谢谢. In this lesson, we will learn some of the most common greetings used in China. 准备好了吗? Are you ready? 我们开始吧。 So, let's start.The most commonly used greeting is 你好你好 You may remember this from lesson 1. 你好 means hi, hello, and how do you do? It's a slightly formal expression though, so just use it at work or similar occasions. Don't use it with your family and friends. The informal hello is sure to be familiar to you. You probably use it every day already. Hey, hey.If it sounds familiar, it's because it's just like English hey, but make sure to say it with the right Mandarin tone. Hey. When you want to greet someone in the morning, you can also say 早啊早啊 It's very commonly used, but it's slightly informal. What about when we leave? What should we say? 再见 This very common expression is similar in meaning to the English see you again.再见 This is goodbye. Though simple, it can be used in almost all occasions. Now, you can greet people in many different ways in Chinese. Let's review them all again. When meeting people for the first time or in a formal occasion, 你好 When meeting friends or family members, you can say, hey. In the early morning, you can say, 早啊 When leaving,No matter whether it's a formal or informal situation, 再见 It's easy, isn't it? Now it's time for Yanru's tips. As you know, there are more and more Chinese starting to learn English. This has started to affect the language. Just like how you can say hey instead of 你好, you can also say bye bye instead of 再见. So if you forget how to say 你好 and 再见, you can use the easy,Heys and bye-byes, and people will understand you with no problem. During the next lesson, we'll learn the meaning of the phrase 你会说英语吗? Do you already know it? I'll be waiting to talk about it with you in our next 三分钟汉语 lesson. 再见! Hey, 大家好，我叫马燕如。 Hey everybody, I'm Yanru Ma. Welcome to ChineseClass101.com's 三分钟 汉语, the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. In the last lesson, we learned the most common forms of greetings in Chinese. Do you remember them? In this lesson, we're going to learn a very useful phrase. Do you speak English? If you find yourself in a situation where you need assistance in English, this phrase can be a lifesaver. But because you're asking it in Chinese, you can be sure that everyone will understand what you are saying, even if the answer is no. Here is a common, slightly informal way to say it. 你会说英语吗? 你会说英语吗? Let's break that down. You, 你, can, 会, speak, 说, English, 英语, question mark particle, 吗? You will notice the word 你 in the beginning of the sentence. Remember that this is the way to say you. The next word, 会, is like the English can. Then we have the verb 说, which means to speak. Next up is 英语, the word for English. And last we have 吗? This is used to ask a question. It works just like a question mark. Put it at the end of the sentence with a low tone. Altogether, it's 你会说英语吗? To learn how to properly use verbs like 会, please look at our Absolute Beginner series on ChineseClass101.com. You can find very detailed grammar lessons and resources there. We are now going to make this sentence formal. First, we need to use the formal version of you, which is 您. Even if we change the word for you, we don't need to change the verb 会. Everything stays the same. 您会说英语吗? 您会说英语吗? Adding 请问, the sentence becomes even more polite. It means something like, excuse me, here. Altogether, it's 请问您会说英语吗? The responses you will receive could be one of these three. 会, yes. 会, or 会, 我会说一点. Yes, I can speak a little. 会, 我会说一点. Or 我不会说. No, I don't. 我不会说. Since this last one is a negative statement, we need to say the negative word 不 before the verb 会. It's just that easy. Now it's time for Yanru's tips. For those of you who are not only English speakers, you can use this question with any language you need. More and more Chinese people are studying other languages, so maybe you will get lucky. Just replace 英语 with 意大利语 for Italian, 俄语 for Russian, 西班牙语 for Spanish, 德语 for German. This lesson we mentioned the expression 请问, but did you know that this could also be used as an apology? In the next lesson, we will learn this and other ways to apologize in Chinese. I will see you in our next 三分钟 汉语 lesson. 再见! Hey, 大家好, 我叫马燕如. Hi, everybody, I'm 燕如 Ma. Welcome to ChineseClass101.com's 三分钟汉语, the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. In the last lesson, we learned how to count in Chinese. I hope you spend some time practicing numbers, because they will come in handy for this lesson. We're going to learn how to go shopping in China. Before we go, you need to know how to say how much is this. 这个多少钱? 这个多少钱? Are you ready to go shopping in China? Let's go! You see something you like and want to ask the shopkeeper how much it costs. The first thing to say is, 请问. Do you remember what that means? Excuse me.
请问这个多少钱?请问这个多少钱?
If we want to be more specific when asking, how much is this? Or refer to a certain type of object, it's super easy. We just need to add the noun. For example, 帽子, a hat.
请问这个帽子多少钱?
Excuse me, how much is this hat?
请问这个帽子多少钱?
Another example, 杯子, cup.
请问这个杯子多少钱?
Excuse me, how much is this cup?
请问这个杯子多少钱?
At this point, the shopkeeper can answer by saying 这个, which means this.And then the cost. For example,
这个五十五元。
What number is 五十五? I'm not telling you. Okay, it's 55. It costs 55元. If you think it's too expensive, say,
能便宜点吗?
This means, can it be a little cheaper? It's really useful in China.But it won't work if you are in something like a large department store where bargaining isn't allowed. At this point, can you count renminbi in Chinese? We're going to learn how to do this and much more in the next lesson. I'll be waiting for you in our next 三分钟汉语 lesson. 再见!
Hey everybody, I'm Yanruma. Welcome to Chinese Class 101.com's 三分钟汉语, the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Chinese. In the last lesson, we learned the phrase 这个多少钱? How much is it? In this lesson, let's see how we could answer that question by counting 人民币 in Chinese.In China, the currency is the 人民币. Please pay attention to this word's pronunciation, 人民币. Let's try to say prices in Chinese. Start by trying to say 26 yuan and 5 jiao.
26元五角26元五角
1元 equals 10 jiao and 1 jiao equals 10 fen.But nowadays, we don't often use 分, so you just need to remember 元 and 角. So this is really straightforward. First, we say the number of 元, then 元, and the number of 角, and then 角. Let's try another example. 34 元 and 1角
34元一角34元一角
Get ready for the next example. 99 yuan and 8 jiao.
99 yuan, 8 jiao. 99 yuan, 8 jiao.
That takes a lot of effort to say, doesn't it? Don't worry, you can shorten it in this way. You don't need to say, jiao, you can leave it out. When you do this, though, you shouldn't say, yuan.Quite instead. So we can change 99元八角 to 99块八99块八 Now it's time for Yanru's tips. Actually, 块 is a very common saying, and you can use it almost everywhere in China, although it is not formal. People seldom say 元, but it's always used in writing or formal occasions.You should ask your friends in China if they want to go shopping with you. That will make it easy to practice these phrases.
But first, you will have to check if they have other plans or not. Do you know how to ask that in Chinese? If not, I will see you in the next lesson. 再见。
Expand your vocabulary with our Core 2000 Words ebook. It's free and packed with essential expressions that you'll use on a daily basis. Start building your vocabulary today. Click the link in the description below to download your free Chinese ebook before it's gone.